is as violent as a mugger, as frightening as an armed robber, and as deadly as a hitman. Good evening and welcome. This is Face the Nation. Tomorrow we will witness yet another cabinet reshuffle of the coalition government. And in light of all this and more, right now the problem is the Sri Lankan rupee. The rupee has depreciated to its lowest level in its history, hitting 158 against the US dollar at present. In light of all this, we are trying to find answers to the following questions. Is Sri Lanka sinking deeper into a debt trap? Are we acting based on the whim and fancy of the International Monetary Fund? And if so, at what cost? And then, of course, the Sri Lankan rupee. How is it going to affect the country's economy in the future? Will it make you rich? We'll find answers to all this and more in a moment. Joining us this evening, let me introduce you our guests. Joining us this evening Professor Siri Hettige, Emeritus Professor, Department of Sociology, University of Colombo. Nice to have you on board, Professor Hettige. All joining us this evening on tonight's show is Ramal Jayasinghe, President, National Chamber of Exporters. Nice to have you on the show as well, Ramal. All joining us this evening is Dr. Nandalal Weerasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor, Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Nice to have you on the show for the first time, Dr. Weerasinghe. Dr. W. J. Vardhana, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, will also join us in a short time from now. Joining us this evening again for the first time is Dinesh De Silva, immediate past Chairman, Import Section, Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Nice to have you on board as well, Dinesh.
Thank you.
So let's start off tonight's show with Dr. Nandalal Weerasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Dr. Weerasinghe, alarming bells right now for the government. There is a red light, 158 against the US dollar. Where are we heading now and where are we standing at the moment? Is Sri Lanka going bankrupt? The time starts now.
Thank you. First of all, let me thank the MTV for giving this opportunity to explain and discuss this thing. It's a very important topic. Especially the exchange rate, these days a lot of people are talking about exchange rate and lowest value ever, that as you mentioned here. If you look at the history of exchange rate, in fact, this lowest value has been recorded several times for last, say, 35 years, starting from 8 rupees a dollar back in 1976, now 158 rupees a dollar in terms of US dollar. Here, I mean, also you mentioned a very important point, the inflation. So from the central bank point of view, what we are concerned, our main job is to maintain inflation at a relatively stable level, which means inflation is at a low and stable level. What we think that level would be between 4 to 6%, that we have announced we want to maintain inflation around between 4 and 6% on medium to long term basis. That is our main objective. So while we are trying to maintain that inflation target, so also make sure the inflation 4 to 6% means cost of living or general price levels are increasing every year by at least 4 to 6% in between. It is not cost of living coming down, it's not prices coming down, it is prices are going increasing around 5% every year. So that we have to accept that fact. This is why we need to maintain inflation around 5%. That is the right level of inflation in our view. That's why we think that's why we need to maintain. When you maintain inflation at this level, how we are going to do that? So our monetary policy framework is clearly targeting for us to maintain inflation that way. So if you look at current inflation, in Colombo consumer price index basis, inflation is 4%. If you look at national consumer price index, which is 2.2%. So we are either at the lower level of the inflation band or at 2.2%. Then obvious question is why the currency is depreciating. So that's an important question. So when, from the central bank point of view, what we are concerned, currency has always been moving in one direction. Now sometimes it has appreciated, but a lot of times it has been depreciating. What we need to ensure is that this currency depreciation wouldn't have an impact on overall inflation, which is 5%. If that is causing inflation to go above 5%, it's going to create inflation at 10%, then obviously we have to take strong actions to curtail that. But if you look at the depreciation of the currency in last, for example, now last 10 years, from 2010 onwards, after the end of the war, so there, it was a different regime earlier. So I have numbers here. Every year, for example, now there are 2 years, back in 2012 and 2015, currency has depreciated by 10%. 2011, 10%, 2015, 9%. Now last year, currency depreciated against the US dollar only by 2%. So far this year, 3%. Why then people think about this? That's because historically lowest level. Obviously, when currency depreciate at a rate or even at a lower rate, it always hits the lowest point.
So, Dr. Virasinghe, I just want to interrupt you for a second here. You spoke about inflation standing at 4%, and your target is to ensure that the inflation stands between 4% and 6%.
Yes.
However, the income level of the citizens of Sri Lanka is not increasing. Isn't this something of concern to the central bank of the country?
I mean, just to make that kind of statement. So, for example, we are looking at income as a overall country's income, which is gross domestic product, what we call GDP. Obviously, GDP in real terms in 2017 grown by only 3%, which is much lower and which is not the right level of growth in GDP. But right level of gross domestic product or country's gross income in real terms, if you take out the inflation, what I'm talking about the real terms, will have to increase at least by 5% to make people's income growing at a reasonable rate so that they can meet increasing cost of living, you know, meet the inflation at least 4%. For example, now inflation is 4%. General incomes will have to also be increased at least 4 to 5% to meet balance those things, you know. So income is not growing at 4-5%, and your prices you are facing are increasing at 4-5%. Then obviously, in net basis, you are basically at the same time. The issue is that if economy is growing below 5%, then obviously overall welfare of the country of people will be declining over a period of time. But if you look at historically, last year was the lowest year. That's true, that we all recorded here. But Sri Lanka has a potential. If the right policies are in place, Sri Lanka can grow at least above 5%. There's no question about that. If you look at countries, the way countries are growing.
Just above 3%, Dr.
In 2017, before that it was around 4%. Before that it was some 5%, 6%. So obviously, there is an issue with the GDP growth, overall production of value addition of the goods and services. It has
very increase. Quickly, Dr. Virasinghe, before I move to Dinesh, I want to know the recent statement made by the governor of the central bank, Dr. Indrajit Kumaraswamy, saying that the depreciation of the rupee is not going to in any way impact the debt repayment. I'm trying to find out the logic here, because the rupee has depreciated, Sri Lanka has to pay in rupee terms and ensure that they pay the dollars. And Dr. Kumaraswamy says that there is no effect whatsoever. I'm trying to understand the logic here.
Yeah, I think that's a very important question. A lot of people wouldn't understand this. So if you look at the here we are talking about external debts. Let's say our external debt stock at this point is in US dollar terms, foreign currency terms, US dollar 30 billion. Government external debt stock 30 billion. So here the argument is that if rupee depreciated by 1 rupee, this 30 billion US dollar stock, if that is denominated in rupee terms, will be increased by another 30 billion rupees, if that is written in rupee terms. Say now, then the argument is that, okay, because of the currency depreciated by 1 rupee, government has to incur additional 30 billion rupees expenditure in terms of debt service payments. If you look at face of it, it looks like that is the right way to look at it.
Absolutely.
But, you know, if you think about it, this is 30 billion, you borrow a dollar, if you want to pay a dollar, how would you do this? You have to either borrow $1 or you have to earn a dollar. Either you have to borrow a dollar, either you have to earn a dollar. Doesn't matter what if you are rupees, doesn't make any difference if you don't earn or borrow a dollar. That's how every time government repays, say every year government has to pay $2.5 billion worth of debt service payments. How they do that? You either borrow at least $2.5 billion or get an income related to dollars, like import duties, all this income, similar to something like that. So when you get that $2.5 billion inflow, if currency depreciated by 1 rupee, you would get the additional one rupee for that dollar as well. So it's basically double entry. You know, certainly nominally, your value in rupee terms, nominal value goes up. But if you look at the both sides of the balance sheet, or both sides of the income expenditure statement, it sets off. I mean, net impact of this one. If you borrow a dollar, you have to earn a dollar or borrow a dollar. There's no other way to prepay that dollar. Doesn't matter dollar value of a dollar is 100 rupees or 150 rupees.
Thank
when you
much.
Borrow it, you get it more. I mean, that
Thank
is a simple
much,
logic. I mean, a lot of people only looking at, suppose in accounting terms, look at the balance sheet, look at the liability side.
Thank you very much.
Without looking at the asset side, in the income statement, look at only the expenditure side, don't look at the income side. Then
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Nandalal Wirasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. I now move my attention to Dinesh De Silva, immediate past chairman, import section, Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. The last bit that was mentioned by Dr. Nandalal Wirasinghe saying the only way that you can earn this dollar is by either putting a levy on import duties and getting across the money that is required. So that means that your job is going to be more difficult. Right now, the dollar has depreciated against the US dollar and we're having a problem. Imports are going to be costly. So that means that burden is going to be passed on to the consumer. And then you have the Central Bank of Sri Lanka trying to earn that dollar from import duties itself. In this equation, where does it put the importers of Sri Lanka? And what can we expect in the next few months? Are we going to see a rise in prices or are the importers going to bite the bullet this time? The time starts now.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think we are talking a very timely topic today. And thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to voice our opinion. And I think we have to understand that we are an import dependent economy. And large amount of essential goods and the other imports, plants and machineries, the imports for re-exports, all that, which are playing a very critical role to the country's economy, is largely imported. Now, moment you say imported, the criticality of the exchange rate comes to surface. So, the exchange rate is something that every importer, every trader considers when they are doing a costing for the landed price of the import, based on which they do all their future activities and pricing. So in the global scenario, whenever you are importing, in case if those inputs are going back to exports, you know, few cents here and there, you lose your market. It's such a competitive market outside our country, in the region and global level. So the other important thing is that the goods coming for local consumption, that again, this volatility, this fluctuation has really, really hurt the traders. The large amount of essential foods like sugar, dal, all that, whatever imported are price fixed, which are based on the global markets where the traders don't have control. But from the time that fixed term contracts are agreed and by the time it reaches the country, due to the exchange fluctuation, really the price that lands here it's really too much. And like you quite rightly say, the traders can't absorb that shock, obviously, that is being passed back to the consumers. So on the other hand, now when it comes to imports, the exchange rate plays a critical role. And also when you go to the market today, and what can you buy for 100 rupees? The guys who are really buying goods in the market, they feel the pressure because the money has really devalued more than the numbers speak. So as a result of that, these guys are struggling and they will obviously cut there are extra expenses, extra spending, and as a result of that, the businesses will feel that, you know, the supply over demand is really not serving the purpose. As a result of that, the market is shrinking. People are not spending, market is shrinking. Then what happens to the normal businesses? They feel, you know, they are getting hammered from all corners. And at the same time, the imports for re-export, when those things, those prices keep fluctuating, there's a huge disadvantage for the economy. The SMEs, especially not like big companies, SMEs struggle with their prices. So if SMEs are not supported well, and these external factors are hitting them one after the other, apart from the exchange rate, there are tax regimes that have come, and you know, there are double, triple impacts. So what, how do we protect the SMEs, which is the future of this country economy? And then it is like, you know, the traders, the importers, they are in like mid-sea, you know, they are pushed into mid-sea. You have two options, either to swim or sink. Now,
thank you very much,
when you're trying to swim, yes, yes, there are so much of external barriers, trade barriers, where you can't swim. So
thank,
I think we
much
got to really take a note of that.
Thank you very much, Dinesh. Immediate past chairman, import section, Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Either you sink or swim, the choice is yours. I now move attention to Ramal Jasinghe, president, National Chamber of Exporters. Ramal, many might think that the exporters are the ones who are laughing here because they're getting a better return on the depreciation of the rupee against the US dollar.
On face value, yes.
On face value, they would think, yes, of course, this is a hunky-dory.
No rupees for your
and the exporters should be happy about it and should stop complaining about it. However, right now, that's not the case. Most of the exports that happen in Sri Lanka are value addition. They bring down goods from China. They import these materials and then they re-export it, and the price will go up, and Sri Lanka becomes a lesser competitive competitor in the marketplace. How is the depreciating of the rupee really affecting the Sri Lankan economy in the long term? The
time very starts true. I think Dinesh answered a lot of that on the impact of the export, because it's one thing is value addition, and the second thing is the export effort has not done enough for import substitution. Now, there was a time, a regime probably 30, 40 years back, I think the governor would, deputy governor would may remember with the statistics on, that there was a push for export substitution. Now, we have been adding value. We have been in the garment industry, which has shown, I think, a 72% growth last year. And on the other hand, the agriculture, tea, has shown a 14% growth in terms of production and export revenue. So these all depend on imports, on the inputs. So these have come a time where the benefits of the more dollars, more rupees for a dollar can be outweighed by the costs or the cost of production, and hence competitiveness. And also this is on the face or on the back of the various free trade agreements that we are signing up, where it does not mean, I mean, free trade is welcome, and it's something that is essential to boost our exports and to boost trade. But again, we are not exporting sufficiently to the countries that we are having the free trade agreements with. So then there is another issue related with exports in general. But on the face of it, we are watching very carefully, and it would be disastrous if there's a free fall of the rupee, and we hope that the central bank would intervene at some point. And playing devil's advocate and being judging from the central bank report, annual report, which I released last week, I think there's a lot of education that the central bank has to do in terms of, particularly in terms of fiscal consolidation. And I think that's where all this is heading towards. And whether it's too much too soon, whether the timing is correct, whether the general public can take the pressures of the tax regime and the various changes that are happening in the monetary field. And I suppose these are for national.
Ramal, one of the allegations against the central bank of Sri Lanka at present is taking haphazard decisions and taking actions too soon without looking at and waiting and taking probably a reactive approach. They always try to take proactive approaches most of the time and gets it all wrong. In your opinion, as an exporter, how do you view this allocation that has been leveled at the Central Bank of Sri Lanka at present?
The export value chain has so many links, and the central bank and the fiscal policy just is one of them. So it has to fall in sync with the ease of doing business, with the FDIs, with tourism, so many things that bring in the foreign exchange in itself and develop our exports. I cannot speak for the timing or the haphazard, if you could call it, of the central bank. I suppose the deputy governor can explain that. But what we see as professionals is that probably there is a requirement to do all this. But on the other hand, there's a public that, and there's SMEs, as Dinesh just mentioned, that are struggling. For example, some of the reliefs that we got from the Inland Revenue Act, you need to have 80% of exports to qualify for those concessions. Now, how can an SME that is just starting off build up 80%? Where he'll have to have the local market to consolidate or to be able to support the exports. So there are a lot of factors. So I think probably a lot has been said in the public space about the difficulties. And I'm sure we through the chambers represent our issues. And we look forward to them being heard and addressed.
Deaf ears? No, it doesn't.
I'm sorry?
Does it fall on deaf ears?
Well, I must say, they listen.
They listen but not act.
Well, not as fast as we would like to, but I'm sure it's a practical issue.
Thank you very
much. I'm playing devil's advocate here.
Ramal, President, National Chamber of Exporters. I now move my attention to Professor Siri Hettige, Emeritus Professor, Department of Sociology, University of Colombo. Professor Hettige, I want to ask you something very simple. You know the International Monetary Fund, and every country that the IMF has gone into has seen either relief in the very, very long term, or you've seen them, the countries have sinked further. Examples are Greece. You've seen this happening in Europe quite heavily. And most often than not, this is because the policies don't align with the policies of that particular country in question. My question to you is very simple. Dr. Veerasinghe, in his opening remarks, said, if we get our policies right, we will be able to achieve a growth of 5% in the future. What policies should we have in place right now? We are right now acting based on the whim and fancy of the International Monetary Fund. That is quite evident. Where are we heading right now at the moment? What are the policies that we need to adopt and make it a homegrown solution for the economic issues that we're facing at present? Your time starts now.
Well, I think we need to probably go beyond some of the things that we have been talking about if we were to really understand what is going on here. I don't think that that what we are observing today is unprecedented. In fact, the value of the rupee has been going down and down, from many years back. For instance, there was a time I remember rupee was valued at dollar was valued at 7 rupees, but of course today we are talking about 160, which means that it's a very, very big difference between 7 rupees and 158 rupees. But the point is that if you think only in terms of money, in terms of inflation, in terms of income, and so on and so forth, I think we will probably not really go very far in understanding our situation. My point is that if you look at the export issues that one of our colleagues mentioned, and the import issues the other our other colleague mentioned, I think here we are talking about the structure of the economy, Sri Lanka's economy. So without really looking at the structure of the Sri Lanka economy, I don't think that we can understand this problem. I'm not an economist, but I have a feeling that why are we so import dependent?
And I think that's partly because we know we really don't produce a lot of the things that we import here. So the question, of course, is whether we really have to import all what we are importing today. I mean, there might be a need for rationalizing our imports, and basically that would depend, you know, whether we really build, you know, our own capacity to produce some of those things. And the same thing, you know, applies to, you know, exports. You know, I think again it depends on the structure of our economy. And what is the structure of our economy? In fact, we are not really talking very much of an industrial economy in this country anymore, because I mean, we all know that the primary industries that were there did not really last long after liberalization, and of course we moved into you know, garment industry, which expanded quite rapidly, but now we have seen also a contraction, and then the industrial sector has not really diversified. So I think the structure of the economy is key here. So I think we probably have to concentrate on that. And also, I don't think that we can look at only income and wages to really talk about the problems that the ordinary people face. We also have to look at, you know, the expenditure that the people have to incur in order to have a decent existence.
Professor Hettige, let me pose a very quick question to you. Who is at fault? Are the respective governments who've been in power at fault for all this mess that the country is going through at present?
Well, I think the point is that that we are talking about division of labor. Certainly, in that context, public policy making is very critical. That's why we elect governments, and the governments, you know, certainly you know, depend very much on institutions. Like the central bank and, you know, various other policy-making bodies in various sectors. And I think we really have to concentrate on public policy. You know, I mean, you mentioned the International Monetary Fund. But I think, you know, the countries have to have their own capacity to analyze the situation and come up with appropriate policies. And, of course, you know, we have in our institutions the capacity to come up with, you know, policy analysis, and based on policy analysis, you know, certain policy recommendations to the government to adopt.
You say Professor Hettige, that policymakers are the very critical point in this whole equation. If that is the case, why must the people pay the brunt for this?
This is exactly the point. I mean, the point is that the you know, the people, when we talk about people, they also play a dual role. For instance, sometimes, you know, governments cannot take you know, long-term policy decisions because they come under popular pressure. They are supposed to, you know, really respond to popular pressure, and therefore they postpone long-term policy making, and they basically respond to the situation here and now by adopting very pragmatic, sometimes very ad hoc, sometimes even very populist kind of measures. So I think it's a two-way thing. I mean, but on the other hand, we really have to strengthen our capacity to analyze our situation, whether from an economic point of view or from a broader social perspective.
Thank you very much.
And come up with, you know, policy options that can be, you know, really looked at by the powers that be in terms of, you know, what is really best. At the time, I think I mentioned this structure of the economy thing.
Thank you very much.
I think we certainly have to look at the structure of our economy and see how best we could restructure this economy to address the issues that that our panelists have been talking about, whether it is from the point of view of imports, exports, or from the point of view of you know, managing you know, the economic fundamentals at a national level.
I think in basic terms, it's very simple. Let the professionals run the show, and let the ministers do what they're really good at doing. So I open the floor for questions from our journalists as well. On to my immediate left is Nadine Majid. On my far left is Charita Fernando. So let's open tonight's show with Charita.
Thank you, Shamit. My first question is to Dr. Veerasinghe. Dr. Veerasinghe, the extended 3-year extended fund facility of the IMF has come under a lot of flack for the current flexible exchange policy that the central bank is following. So, and at the central bank press conference itself, the governor said that the bank decided not to intervene in defending the currency. At what point would you think of defending the rupee?
No, I think I have to provide the clarification. It's not that we do not intervene. As it's very clearly mentioned, if the currency is moving unnecessarily, there's a high volatility, you would certainly intervene. That's, I want to make it very clear. That is the message we want to convey. And on the currency flexibility, exchange rate flexibility, it is necessary. Not that, as you mentioned, free fall. I think you need to give me certain time to respond. There are four issues I want to respond to out of this all three. One is on the currency. So what we are trying to prevent, first thing is to have a kind of a sharp depreciation or appreciation of the currency within a short period of time. In fact, that has happened in the past. If I give you an example, in 2012 April, currency from 113, we have been defending the currency by running down our reserves. Almost $4 billion we spent to maintain currency at 113, and all of a sudden we had to withdraw. There's no resource available, sufficient resource. The currency went up to 113 to 130 within a very short period. And again in 2015, we spent another about almost $2 billion to defend the currency at a certain rate around 130, and we then at point we had to let it go and suddenly went up to 145. So we have clearly mentioned in our roadmap, in governance statements, central bank statements, we are trying to prevent that kind of a sharp depreciation or appreciation, that kind of volatility. That is what he mentioned, free fall. We all agree that kind of free fall is bad for any kind of economic management. But also we need to understand, we need to maintain a competitive currency to maintain our export competitiveness, to promote our exports. That is the very reason that he mentioned Sri Lanka is an import-dependent economy. So that is the very reason why we need to promote exports, why we need to maintain a competitive currency, why we need to allow some gradual depreciation of the currency to maintain export competitiveness, not a free fall.
But Dr. Veerasinghe, Ramal very clearly pointed out the depreciation of the rupee is not even helping exports at the end of the day.
Yes, I'm surprised that he mentioned that. You know, if exporters saying depreciation of currency is not helping the exporters, so the first time I heard that.
The imports, really. Let me clarify that. Either the imports on the exports, because it is again value addition has.
Absolutely. Coming from a tea export background, we import most of the raw materials from China, we import raw materials from India, and then we become less competitive in the marketplace, Dr. Veerasinghe. So it's really affecting exporters as well.
Yeah, certainly. If you look at your product, if you produce locally, if your local value addition, you will have a important component. For example, let's say tea, kilo of tea. What is the important component of a kilo of tea? I would say 10%. So 90% is basically domestic value addition. So when the currency depreciates, for each kilo of tea, for example, now it is say for $4 a kilo. So if you say, instead of getting 150 rupees for your $4 a kilo, it's better off for you to get 100 rupees a kilo, would you be better off?
I just want to just clarify a little bit on yeah. that, Dr. Veerasinghe. Let's say the Sri Lankan tea right now stands a bare minimum of $3.95 at the moment per kilo. Yeah. You can buy the same tea from India for a lesser price, which stands at only $1.25
yes.
per kilo.
Right.
So you buy 90% of the raw material from India, that is the tea, that the CTC that you blend with Sri Lankan tea, which is 10%, and then you re-export it back. So then what happens there?
No, that's you are talking about import and export, re-export. That
yes,
is only
absolutely.
Trade. That is, there's very little value addition. This is not what we want to promote. This we want to promote as a country to export. You need to have more domestic value addition. You need to have better price, even in rupee terms, for tea that is produced in Sri Lanka. Then obviously that business, if that is like Singapore, you import and export. It's a complete trading economy. That's also a good model. And then obviously you forget about your local domestic tea industry. Say, for example, currency appreciates for your dollar instead of getting 150 per kilo. If you are going to get 100 rupees a kilo, then what are you going to pay for your smallholder? What is a kilo of the smallholder tea plant, tea plant
sector?
Are they going to survive? Are they being able to pay the wages for these people?
Let's take a look at Sri Lanka at present. You know, we have a ban from Japan for our Sri Lankan tea. Why? Because of public policy. Because of policy that has been taken by the government.
That's a different issue, obviously. Let's talk about the...
But where are we standing right now? We're looking at the longer picture. Whereas we are already killing what we have on board, that is the Sri Lanka tea industry. And then we are talking about the bigger picture about how we should move towards ensuring that we have a domestic raw material market for tea. We have already almost killed the Japanese tea market.
No, you see, these are two different issues.
Absolutely,
but
shouldn't it be aligned with the government's thinking at the end of the day?
No, the tea industry, there's another debate. If Sri Lanka wants to become a hub of the tea, you know, tea industry, the global tea hub, then obviously, you know, you need to allow import and export and natural gas. That's a different debate. I'm not going to get into it because there's even industry people have a different views on this. This is about gradual depreciation of the currency on tea export.
Ramal, do you agree with Dr. Veer Singh's
statement? Any exporter saying gradual depreciation of the currency is bad for exports, I think we have to have a different economic model. I think.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vijayavardhan, for joining us this evening. We, of course, will get back to you in a minute, but I want to get Ramal's views on this.
Yeah, I think, as I said earlier, it is the lack of import substitution, right, that is creating this impact. Now, okay, if you take the tea industry, there's obviously fertilizer that we import, right? That has a direct impact on petroleum prices and other macroeconomic factors. So then the other thing, the cost of production. I think labor has been a major domestic issue for the tea industry. So those factors apart from, and that will also contribute to the depreciation. Now we are looking at one side of the depreciation where you can get more rupees to your dollar. Fine. And a lot of us had, as I said at the beginning, at face value, the depreciation sounds good to the exporter. But again, I mean, this is our members' views, that you the inputs that come into the export effort are imported. I would say about 45%, I stand corrected, but about 45% of our export effort depends on imports. And again, the value addition. So the depreciation could outweigh the benefits that we'll get from our exports, from the more rupees coming into our balance sheets.
Dr. Vijayavardhana, Dr. Veer Singh has said the president and the former deputy governors are in the studios this evening, which is an honor for us as well. Dr. Veer Singh says that we don't want to be a Singaporean model right now. We want to be a domestic-oriented model. However, Sri Lankan politicians have been going on saying we have to be like Singapore, we have to be like Singapore, we have to be like Singapore. And seems like...
I didn't say that's bad. See, that's also moral, I said. Yeah. That can also be done.
That can also be done, but...
Open free trade.
Right now, based on what we're doing right now in terms of the Sri Lankan rupee, obviously we don't want the Singaporean model at present. That's what I recollect or I gather. Where are we really heading? I posed this question to you last December, Dr. Vijayavardhan, when you were on the show. You were talking about the country's economy and where it stands in the year 2018. You said they will realize all this, what they're managing, that they're managing the economy wrong by April. And now, almost in the first week of May, people are feeling the brunt. And you seem to have had a magic ball in front of you to predict the future. What has gone wrong, Dr. Vijayavardhan?
Well, I think we have to make it clear, Samir, the central bank has done its job of reducing the inflation rate and making the macroeconomic stability more acceptable to for future economic growth and for investors to invest and have trust in the future. And the main issue has arisen not from the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. The main issue has arisen from the government of Sri Lanka, which has failed to deliver its own promise to the economy. Its own promise is that the Central Bank can only maintain the macroeconomic stability, and it's doing it now in a very subtle way, gradually, and also it is progressing towards that goal. But in the case of the government, we find that the government has not done anything in the last 3.5 year period in order to realize the benefits out of coming from this present macroeconomic stability that is coming to Sri Lanka. And the main reason is that we had been warning the government from 2015 onwards that Sri Lanka is going moving towards an external sector crisis, because our imports are very much high, exports were stagnating during that period, and there was a huge trade deficit which was partly financed by the remittances that had come to Sri Lanka. And also Sri Lanka was forced to borrow abroad in order to finance the gap in the current account. Now this cannot be continued forever, and the government should have done enough work to diversify the export sector as promised in the first economic policy statement delivered by Prime Minister in Parliament in November 2015, and converting gradually the Sri Lanka economy from the simple technology based exports to high-tech based exports. And in that respect, the work that had been done by the government has been very slow. In fact, I can say nothing has been done by the government in order to realize that particular objective. So as a result, we are still where we were in year 2015. And if you look at the 2017, the exports have marginally improved. But of course, with the rise in the fuel prices in the world market, we find that the imports have not declined as we have expected. So as a result, we have a shortage of foreign currency in the market. And in the past, what the central bank did was, prior to 2015, they borrowed money from outside, used that money to artificially keep the Sri Lanka rupee stronger. And that cannot be done forever. And that's what I think, if you examine very carefully.
Dr. Vijayavardhan, on that subject, I want to ask this. It's a controversial question. Do you think that the central bank is deluded if it thinks that it can control both monetary policy and currency at the same time?
Yeah, Nadeem, if you had watched the press conference hosted by Governor Indrajit Kumarasamy when they issued the central bank annual report for 2017, he had, in fact, frankly, he had admitted that unlike in the past, he had admitted that we are still not in a better position. And he has said in the case of the foreign reserves, still what is worrying him is that a very large segment of the foreign reserves that we are having is borrowed money rather than earned money. But of course, he said that we had started to improve the quality of the foreign reserves, because central bank had purchased in 2017 some $1.6 billion for the market, which had been improved by another $400 million during the first 4 months of the period, which means we had actually purchased from the market about $2 billion. Now my question is, in order to maintain the exchange rate at this particular current level, you should not waste that money. Because if you borrow money and then use that money in the market in order to stabilize the exchange rate at a given exchange rate, we are actually, what we are doing is, we are losing, on one side we are losing foreign exchange, on the other side we are enhancing the debt stock of the country, which would make Sri Lanka a debt dependent country.
But already what the central bank is doing, isn't it just enabling the government to spend beyond their means?
Well, within the constraints that the central bank has, because you always have to admit the fact, Nadeem, though central bank is an autonomous institution, it has to function within a sovereign state. And when you function within a sovereign state, you don't have the entire freedom that you can exercise, like the Bundesbank in Germany or the Bank of England in UK.
So the government is using the central bank.
Governments have been, not only today, throughout the post-independence period, ever since the central bank of Sri Lanka.
So then I'll make a very controversial argument. Does that mean that the only way we can protect the salaries and the savings of our people is by abolishing the central bank?
That's the problem. That's why, in fact, fortunately, this government had admitted that it wants to make central bank a more independent institution. And I was waiting for that day to come, because we had been fighting for this for a long period of time. Make the central bank independent of the government influences, independent of the influence of the Ministry of Finance, because those are the things that we have to do. Because the present crisis, in the case of the present crisis, what the central bank can do, central bank has already done it. Now it's the ball is with the government. which has to now promote exports and make Sri Lanka rupee a more stable currency.
Mr. Jayasinghe, I'll pose this question here.
Can I just add a small thing to what Mr. Vijayawardena, Dr. Vijayawardena said? Is see, why another reason why we need to build up more resource in terms of quality and non-borrowed resource is just if you look at next 4-5 years debt service payments, historically it's going to be much higher than what we had in the past. So earlier commercial debts are maturing from 19 onwards, every year 1.5 billion each commercial basis. So when you have that kind of debt service payments for the future, obviously we need to have a much higher level of resource, non-borrowed resource. You can, there are two ways. One is you settle the loan by again borrowing. So you just kind of on the screen. Or you build up your buffer so that you can meet that debt service obligations through non-borrowed resources. So that, what is a better way? So that's why it's important, in addition to what Dr. Vijayawardena mentioned, is to build up more reserves on a quality basis through purchases in the market. When it happens, you need to have a flexible exchange rate ready.
So how should you go about that, building up that buffer?
This is where we are trying to, you know, small fluctuations of the currency, we will tolerate. But we will certainly not allow free fall of the currency. Then we will for that rainy day, we will use that resource very carefully.
But Dr.
To prevent that kind of sharp volatility. But we will certainly build up resource out of the export earnings, out of the remittances. Then we build up resource without kind of a, you know, by borrowing government and build up resource is also useful.
But Dr. Weerasinghe, you say that the central bank will tolerate small fluctuations in the exchange rate. But didn't the central bank itself trigger this current plunge in the exchange rate when it printed money to the tune of almost 70 billion rupees over the past month?
That's absolutely not correct. I also thank for asking that question. So money, printing money, so every year central bank, depending on the growth of the economy in nominal terms, need to print out certain amount of money. But so that this, some of the reports saying that central bank has printed this amount of money is absolute. It's not correct. It's completely incorrect statement. We have publishing given all the information in the most transparent manner on a weekly basis, monthly basis. Nowhere, anywhere one can find.
But when you print evidence of printing money.
Printing unnecessary amount of money. I mean, central banks will have to print money all the time.
So now, for this new year season ahead of that, the central bank printed a certain amount of money, 70 billion rupees.
By this time,
shouldn't that money have been already mopped up?
It has come back to the central bank already.
You know, already
every year for the. Before the new year, before the end of before the Christmas, people would like to have cash in the circulation, cash in their hands to gifts and buy shopping, all these things. Demand for currency in up to mid April and up to end December is always as a peak. That has been all the case. If we did not issue currency in circulation sufficient amounts to the banking system, you are going to see a lot of people are queuing up at the ATMs and having a lot of issues. You wouldn't be able to do any transactions. There is a less availability of cash because people demand cash in this. And soon after this thing, the currency comes back. So currency went, so circulation went up to 1,060 billion.
By this time it has come back.
It has come back.
Of the latest cycle of printing money, has that money come back already?
It's sort of come. So
it has been mopped up already.
It has mopped, yes. I mean, I give you numbers. I mean, I already have some.
Nadeem, I think I will clarify it further because what the ordinary members of the public believe that printing of currency is that central bank would print these rupees and cents.
No, but it's through double entries.
Yeah, that's not what is happening because if you want to look at the central bank's printing of currency, you have to look at the reserve money base of the central bank. Which consists of the rupees and cents received by the central bank plus the demand deposits which the central bank is holding for commercial bank. That is the actual base on which the country can print more money. And that particular way that what has happened in the last 3-week period is that the reserve money base had increased from about say 925 billion about 3 weeks ago to about 1,040 billion, the latest data released by the central bank.
Yeah, but Dr. Vijayawardhan, the main problem for me here is that now, for me, the money that I'm earning is worth a lot less, especially if you are buying a lot of imported goods, etc. The money that you're earning is worth a lot less. I'm wondering, shouldn't we just like go back to the Bretton Woods system, the gold standard? You're only allowed to have as much money as, yeah, I mean, as you have gold in your vault.
If you can go back to the gold standard, of course, that's the best way that you'll be able to stabilize the prices. But what happens is that the gold standard is not flexible enough for you to meet the requirements of a growing economy. So that's why the countries had moved away from the gold standard to this fractional resource system.
Professor, when you really look at all this, you know, it seems very nice to hear Dr. Vijayawardhana and Dr. Veerasinghe backing the argument about printing the money and ensuring that it comes back. However, when you speak to a lot of businessmen these days, they say that businesses have drastically dropped. People don't have the spending power anymore. They don't have the saving power anymore. And business has been worse since the end of the conflict in Sri Lanka. That was the year 2018, April season. So given the fact what you hear from Dr. Veerasinghe as well as Dr. Vijayawardhana backing the argument of, about printing money, having the circulation right, there is no problem at all, but people don't have the money anymore.
Well, I think the central bank is not the only institution that generates data, analysis and information for us to discuss these issues.
Absolutely.
I mean, there are related data that we have to look at coming from other institutions, like for instance the Census and Statistics. I looked at the 2016 household income and expenditure survey data, and I saw you know, some very interesting picture emerging out of that data set. For instance, you know, it's basically income and expenditure, and as you know, you know, we can look at GDP and we can also look at GDP per capita, but I think there is also a lot more to it than GDP and GDP per capita. For instance, you can look at household income distribution. Say, for instance, you know, if you take you know, income earners, you can basically stratify the income earners from the lowest to the highest. And I saw an interesting pattern, that is, you know, when you look at the first 50% of the income earners, households, you know, there is an income deficit. In other words, when you look at the income and expenditure, income is less than expenditure if in the case of, you know, 50% of the lower income. And then when you look at the higher income, you know, 50%, there of course there's an income surplus. In other words, income is, you know, lower than the expenditure. So, but the point that I'm trying to make here is that when we look at the declining value of the rupee, we are talking about, you know, declining purchasing power for everybody. But certainly it is not going to impact on everybody equally, and certainly that 50% of lower income group is going to be affected adversely. But this has an impact also on what would these people do. I mean, certainly their capacity to borrow is very limited, but on the other hand, if they borrow, they become more indebted. But there's another important implication, and that is, you know, we are also not only dependent on imports, we are also dependent on remittances. Why are we dependent so much on remittances? We have nearly 300,000 people, 260,000 or whatever, leaving this country, you know, every year, you know, to find employment overseas. And then we also have a stock of about 1.6 million out of just over 8 million labor force employed outside the country. And this, of course, has remained fairly stable over the last 10 years. Of course, you know, we started with a few thousand people migrating. Now, the question is this. Now, labor is, as you know, is one of the most critical issues affecting everybody. You know, whether it is, you know, whether it is, you know, exporters, whether it is industrialists, whether it is the tea industry, whether it is, you know, small industries, agriculture, and so on and so forth. So why is industrial, I mean, of course, there are so many issues, but the point is labor itself is a big issue. But now this labor issue is not going to get better, because when you put more pressure on lower half of the population, you know, they will naturally try to find a way out. Because, you know, if you don't create productive and gainful employment in this country, which we do not, naturally they will migrate to wherever they can, and that would naturally put pressure on the labor market again, and wage inflation will naturally increase and so on. So I think we have to probably look at so many loops. It's not just one loop.
Vinesh,
that we are talking about income, you know, expenditure, you know, then also of course cost of living, and how people react to these situations and so on. And of course the other point is, I mean, the public policy we have to discuss. I mean, the transition that we have made long time back from labor intensive to technology intensive, we have not done anything at all to address that issue. And
Minister,
I think that is something that I have been talking a great deal about. I know, we have enough research institutes established in almost every field in this country. But the point is that we haven't really enhanced the capacity of these institutes.
Sri Lanka is also famous for appointing a lot of committees as well, Professor.
We'll discuss that, because I think that is really the most critical issue.
Absolutely.
Because the structure of the economy is key.
In a minute,
I mean, all these issues that we are talking about, it's very much impinging on that.
I just want to take my attention towards Dinesh, who's been silent for some time. Dinesh, Sri Lanka is looking at, now you say that Sri Lanka is an import-oriented economy. However, Dr. Veerasinghe and Dr. Vijayavardhana both says that we need to go to an export-oriented economy. Now, this doesn't happen overnight. So this means your job in the future is going to be at risk. And at what cost is this going to come?
We are depending on imports heavily, right? So, yes.
That's no secret.
That's no secret, yeah. So we got to change this model, obviously. But at the same time, looking at the global scenarios, now the traditional ways of thinking is no more available. We got to adjust ourselves to modern day business. That is actually largely trading and becoming self-sufficient as well. But the question is whether we really have policies in place to support this model. I think we have discussed this at many, many forums, and imports are going to be extremely vital for the improvement for exports, except for agriculture, even agriculture. You know, especially the technological inputs, the imports have to come in. And also, if we are going to forget the fundamentals of the value of the imports, supporting exports and the economy, we are on the wrong track. The fact
are you trying to say that the central bank is on the wrong track? Let's be very blunt here.
Well, central bank, over the past years, and I mean, continuously, has been supporting the trade, and like doctor said, whenever it is critical, they interfere. But the question is there.
No, but you want to answer my question.
Yeah.
You need to answer my question, or else I'm going to be, intervening quite often.
Okay.
I'm telling you to answer my question. So, very simply, do you think that the central bank is not really serious about importers at the end of the day?
The question is whether the central bank can be serious about the importers, because there are bigger issues that they are tackling, and as a result of that.
But how come? Sri Lanka is an import-oriented economy and they are not bothered about the importers anymore, is it?
The belief is you support exporters, and like Ramal said, we
but even Ramal is complaining.
No. What we immediately feel is like, you know, you get a lot of rupees against the dollars, you're happy. No, it's not the situation, because the cost of production is going up, people's income are not aligned to this inflation, so people want higher monies, higher revenues. So with all that, production is cost is going up, and at the same time, it's a very short term feeling that you will get. That you are getting a lot of money for your dollars. No, it's not going to be a sustainable approach
Thank
going
you
forward.
Much.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dinesh. We're going for a short commercial break, but there are a few points that really need to be understood. A consistent policy. There has been many cabinet reshuffles since 2015. A foreign direct investor wouldn't know where to go if Sri Lanka is looking at becoming an export-oriented economy. There's more things that need to be done. There has to be further strengthening of the country's economy. Ease of doing business has to be in a very satisfactory level. Are we on the right track? To answer all this and more, we're going for a short commercial break, and when we come back, we will try to find the answers. Are we gearing up for the future? Or are we turning back and moving towards the past? All this and more of the short commercial break. Stay connected and stay with Face the Nation. Welcome back. This is Face the Nation. I start off the third round with Dr. W. Vijayawardena, a former deputy governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. As Dr. Vijayawardena is no more at the central bank of the country, he can be more candid about the country's state of affairs as well as the country's economy. Dr. Vijayawardena, I want to ask you somewhat of a political question, because you have many economists in the present regime. You speak about Dr. Harsha De Silva, you speak about a banker, Mr. Eran Wickremratne, you speak about Ranil Wickremesinghe, the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, as one of the economists who has driven the country. You have Charitha Ratwatha, you have Paskar Lingam, you have the names and the heads that are required to drive the country's economy forward. However, that has not happened, unfortunately. My question to you is very simple. In your time in the central bank as well as outside, what has been the worst time for Sri Lanka's economy? Is it this year?
Yeah, I mean, no, I mean, we had earlier, of course, 2009, then 2000. There's a very remarkable history for Sri Lanka's economy, and what happened was, in all those years, we were able to overcome the problems. 2009, of course, when we were in the middle of the war, our foreign reserves fell to about, say, 2 months' imports, and as a result, we had to borrow money from outside. But the country was able to overcome that. But present situation, Samir, is something where we had done it by ourselves. As you say, now, central bank was not permitted to function as an independent institution prior to the appointment of the new governor. And it was actually subservient to the certain politicians in the government. And as a result, what the central bank did was, it was actually supporting, as Dr. Veerasinghe said a few minutes ago, supporting the program which the political authority of the country was having in their own minds. But what is the problem that we are facing today, Samir, is that nothing has been happening in this country in order to develop the real sector economy. Because we were just, you know, making so many announcements like policy statements, vision statements and so forth, but there was no any machinery within the government sector to implement any of those things.
For example, you're saying to drive these policies forward.
Well, they must have a machinery. For example, in the very first policy statement of the Prime Minister in November 2015, he said that he wanted to convert Sri Lanka from a simple technology-based economy to a complex technology-based economy. For that purpose, we had to develop technology. Now, we have 16 universities, we have several research institutions, but the message was not delivered to those institutions in order to develop the required technology for the country, and as a result, it was just a wishful thinking. Now, our problem here is that what the central bank can do is simply to maintain the stability in the macroeconomy, and central bank is doing it very hard. But the development of the real economy is a responsibility of the government. And that part has not been delivered by the government in the last 3 year period. And we cannot expect that it will do the same in the next two year period also, because they have to face so many elections, Samir. And when the when these development policies are implemented, which are very painful, which would annoy the voter base, government might simply postpone it to the next cycle of elections.
Thank you very much, Dr. W. Vijayawardena, former deputy governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Thank you very much for being candid on the show tonight. As always, I now move on to the present senior deputy governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, Dr. Nandalal Veerasinghe. Dr. Veerasinghe, Dr. Vijayawardena makes a lot of sense. He says that consistent policy is important, given the fact that there is a vote, there is an election that's going to come up. There won't be any stringent measures that will be taken by the government. Now, this contradicts to the statement that you made initially, stating that if the government gets its policies right, we can go towards a 5% economic growth. So it seems like all this is an inflation of words and only wishful thinking at present. Seems like we are going down the drain, isn't it?
No, I think what I mentioned, you quite rightly repeated it. If we get it right, So we can reach, or we can grow potentially more than 5% in the future.
How can we get it right?
So
that is where the situation or the surrounding in Sri Lanka itself is not immune towards this.
The structural reforms are very important in terms of, if policies are to be consistent, you need to institutionalize the policy frameworks. For example, for central bank, say after new government came in, we can argue, so as Mr. Rajan said, we are working more independent. But it can't be dependent on the person. You have to have an institutional framework that could ensure whoever the person, whenever there's election, this framework is embedded and incorporated in the law. They institutionalize the frameworks so that it economy will not face the election cycles, and it will not synchronize the business cycles. So that is where the countries, those are successful, to have an independent central bank enshrined by the law, then it doesn't matter who the government comes in, central bank can act independently. Similarly, fiscal policy. For example, now we have what we call Fiscal Management Responsibility Act. There's a law by which government should bring down the fiscal deficit to certain amount within 3 years, need to bring down the fiscal government debt to certain level within a certain period. But if that fails, only thing is go to parliament and explain what happened. Without that thing enshrined in the law and make it, then only these reforms must be institutionalized so that, the policies should be consistent going forward. Then it doesn't matter whether this government or next government or previous government, if there's continuity and predictability in terms of policies and direction, then obviously country will move without any that's what everywhere else, usually successful countries will have doesn't matter. You look at India, their policies are all the time very consistent, and even countries like Singapore, doesn't matter what the government is, in a lot of other countries the policies are very consistent. It can't be changed by persons, or whether the finance minister changes policy can't be changed, whether the ground changes policy can't be changed. It has to be institutionalized. That is where something will have. That's why, as I said, if you get things right, if you can institutionalize all these things, obviously, then we can move forward.
Thank you very much, Dr. Veerasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. I don't want to drill Dr. Veerasinghe too much, because he works for the state. He works as an employee of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, so I do not want to grill too much Dr. Veerasinghe, but thank you very much, Dr. Veerasinghe, for joining us this evening on the show. It's always a pleasure to have someone from the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, because as the host, and Charita has been trying to get someone from the Central Bank for many, many years now, and it's always a pleasure to have you on board. Thank you very much for joining us. I want to move my attention to Ramal Jayasinghe, President of the National Chamber of Exporters. Ramal, I want you to go a little bit out of your forte, which is exports. I want to talk about making sure policies are institutionalized. Dr. Veerasinghe brought this issue up, saying just because people's heads changed, you cannot change policy. However, that has been the case in Sri Lanka at present. The most casing point would be, you had the ministry, the central bank, coming under the purview of the Ministry of Finance and Planning. And this happened even after a new minister was appointed, that is Mangala Samaravisa, as the Minister of Finance. Only recently, a gazette notification was issued by the president himself saying it has to come back again to the Ministry of Finance. Are we really serious about all this, or are we just joking and we're trying to shoot in the dark?
A very timely point that you brought, Shamir. And this is something that the chambers, the National Chamber of Exporters, and we've even spoken with the Ceylon Chamber on consistent policy making, consistent and responsible policy making. And also, I am personally quite intrigued on what the scientific basis of allocating ministries are about. Because I think going back 30 odd years, you had a very limited number of ministries, and you knew where to go to. Now, the exporter's plight is, if he had to go to the agriculture minister, then he had to go to the minister of trade, then he had to go to the minister of trade and commerce, or another ministry. So this complicates matters. So for one decision, you got to have three or four ministries that you got to coordinate with, and each minister or ministry probably works differently. So that makes a delay. Then the other question is, if somebody comes, if we are trying to attract FDIs,
and if somebody wants to set up shop here, where does he go to? Okay, he goes to the BOI. But again, with the BOI, supposed to be a one-stop shop, and they probably do about 85% of what needs to be done. But again, when it comes to setting up an SME or setting up a factory, there are so many authorities he's got to deal with. Now, what we've been clamoring for is a one-stop shop or a rationalized portfolio of ministers and of ministries. And then by that, we hope that consistent policy making, because at the end of the day, it's like a company. If I'm an executive of a company, I would depend on the corporate plan or the consistency of the policies of that company. If that changes over the 4 quarters, how do I perform? So this is where we come from. We are very, very vociferous, if you can call it, about consistent policy. This is something we've been saying at every opportunity. And we hope from tomorrow, probably somebody has heard.
Thank you very much, Ramal Jasinghe, President of the National Chamber of Exporters. Again, maybe wishful thinking, but let's hope and pray that the same cards
are... One could always hope.
That, as I always said 2 weeks ago, the pack will be reshuffled. However, the jokers, of course, would remain in those positions. So let's move on to Dinesh De Silva, immediate past chairman, import section of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Again, Dinesh, I want to take you a little bit out of your forte now, talking about ensuring that policies are institutionalized. Initially, we saw the Cabinet Committee on Economic Management being established. Then we heard that the President took a very stern decision and appointed the National Economic Council in place of the CCEM. What is all this? Is it good to have a coalition government, or is it bad to have a coalition government?
Well,
where are we really heading as a country, as a nation? Because it's sometimes you cannot really stomach what's happening in Sri Lanka. As young professionals, as young media personnel, it's very shameful where the country is being put into or dragged into.
Extremely a tough question that you have posed at me. But yes, I think you are absolutely right. Doing all these changes and taking decisions on very short space of time have really done huge damage to the trade. What happens here is, people lose faith on the trade. People really don't believe the system. So, as a result of that, now exporters may have certain ministries to go, but when it comes to importers, maybe they don't know where to go. They stomach their problems. The entire policy framework has to look at trade issues. Now, these kind of signals are really not encouraging to the FDIs, where we really want FDIs to come into this country. And then change of policies at a frequent level, that is also giving a very bad signal to the trade. Means they cannot plan their businesses over a certain amount of period. Now, putting all together, the state of the importers who are drastically supporting the export sector and the cost of living and the consumers in this country really needs firm policies, policy changes. And when you're talking about the international trade, there are some outdated laws that are still there, starting from customs law, customs ordinance, then import export control act, and then up to a great exchange control act. And also SLPA, these got to be really revised or changed or completely amended. New laws have to come in. Until such time, if we don't put this really correct these laws to suit the modern day business, we are going adding fuel to fire. This is not going to get anywhere, because the traders, what happens is,
we as professionals will be trying to resolve matters. But what happens to the ordinary trader that who is doing business? They just forget it. They resort to all malpractices. They look for shortcuts. And they are really going out of the mainstream. So this is a very bad signal.
Thank you very much, Dinesh Silva, immediate past chairman, import section of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. I now move my attention to Professor Siri Hettige, Emeritus Professor, Department of Sociology, University of Colombo. Professor, I want to take you a little bit out of your comfort zone for a minute now, for 2 minutes now to be very precise. You were also the chairman of the National Police Commission at one point. You tendered your resignation on the 6th of January 2017. My question to you is, did you resign because of inconsistent policy?
Well, the point is that I really wanted to set certain standards, and I wanted everybody to fall in line with those standards, and I wanted to introduce systems. I also wanted to mainstream some of the new ideas that have been floating around and so on and so forth. So the point is that if you really cannot make a difference within a certain period of time, I mean, you know, everything is time bound, and I coming from an academic background, tend to be an idealist, and I didn't really have time to waste. And if I realized that, you know, I cannot really put in place, you know, what I had in mind, then I felt that, well, I should really take a back seat, and I really took a back seat, and I am really not...
Professor Hettige, hasn't this been the problem with this government? You know, inconsistent policy.
Well,
you have four men on your left saying that consistent policy is important, and you here are also saying the fact that this government doesn't have the vision. They did appoint a constitutional council, they did appoint a national police commission, but you were not given the free hand to do and put in place procedures. So isn't this, in a business perspective, the case as well in Sri Lanka at present?
Well, I think this is really not something new in this country. In fact, there have been times where the situation was even worse. But the point is that unless you have a clear perspective for the future, whether it is in terms of institutional development, restructuring the economy, improving the quality of life of the people, you're not going to really get anywhere. And I think the main point here is that that we really come up with ideas, and then we accept those ideas, and then we really do not really follow through. Now, for instance, on this rationalizing the government structure. Actually, the several leaders of the present regime accepted the fact there is a need for rationalizing the government machinery. And in fact, I was very much involved in a process whereby we came out with a whole range of proposals to restructure the cabinet. And then to allocate the various portfolios on a rational basis, and also to even introduce a cluster system whereby you bring the related ministries together so that they will not be working in isolation and so on and so forth. All that is documented, all that was presented to the government, all that was even virtually accepted. But then we have not been able to really implement. And of course, there might be good reasons why this could not be done. Of course, I cannot answer of that. But certainly, there must be reasons why this could not be done. But as a result, of course, we are in this situation today.
Thank you very much.
But the point is that we have basically done away with some institutions that would have certainly helped in this situation. Now, India did not abolish the National Planning Council. I don't know whether they have abolished it now. But in fact, they introduced even a new council called the Knowledge Council under Rajiv Gandhi. So the point is that they realize the need to have, the issues that we are talking about is not economics. It's not just monetary management. It is interdisciplinary. It has so many facets. So the point is that it is important to have integrated perspective on economic management, because you cannot manage the economy without looking at the social situation of the people.
I need to open the floor for questions from our journalists. Yeah. Let me just quickly go to Charita and give you the floor.
My question is to Dr. Vijayavadana. You mentioned some time back that the net beneficiary of a devaluation would be the state eventually.
Yeah, I mean, even today it's the state, because you would have noted, Charita, in the recent past there was a, I think, press release or press announcement by someone that because of the depreciation of the Sri Lanka rupee, the government of Sri Lanka has to pay now more in terms of Sri Lanka rupees, and the debt stock has increased as a result of that. That particular argument is correct only if the entirety of the debt stock matures within 1 year, because then we have to pay that. But the situation is that on one side the government has to have now more rupees to repay its debt during the year. At the same time, it gets more rupees for the foreign exchange that it gets during the year. For example, the import duty. Normally, Sri Lanka gets about $1 billion by way of import duty, and when the rupee depreciates by one rupee, the total additional income to government is about $1 billion. On top of that, the government will get additional funding by way of borrowings, and those dollars are also sold to central bank at a higher rate. Now they get a higher amount. Now if you look at the 2018, on the basis of the budget that was presented in November last year, the government had been expecting about $1 billion by way of import duty, so that the government's additional income is $1 billion. And the government was expecting additional $2.4 billion by your foreign financing on a net basis, so the total inflow to government is about $3.4 billion. But the net repayment of the debt during the year, foreign debt during the year, is about $1.7 billion. So as a result, if the rupee depreciates by one rupee, the net additional income that comes to government is about $1.7 billion. So that's why government is always a net beneficiary, because it has to operate on both sides. Like, you know, here the exporters have to operate on one side, so that's why they have to bear losses, but the government is operating on both sides.
Dr. Veerasinghe, there's this argument in the media that the IMF has to take the blame for low economic growth, for rupee depreciation, higher taxes, economic reforms. It seems like it's the source of all evils. And there's also the argument that the IMF is dictating to a sovereign, imposing conditions. Are they actually dictating to us, and what is the central bank's stand, or how are you negotiating these pressures?
I think this all misperception about the IMF is sovereign choice. It's first of all, government makes a decision whether they go with the IMF, whether they are going to get finance, they need finances from the IMF. If you make that decision, and if you want to take IMF money, for that thing, even from anyone else, say from China, say from USA, say from Japan, the government is going to get some financial assistance. You obviously will have to abide by certain terms and conditions. It's similar with the IMF, because IMF is a multilateral organization. So when they are lending their money to a country, they want to make sure this country should be able to repay that money. Just to ensure that, then we have to come to an agreement with both of us. Will have to agree on a certain terms and conditions, thinking that, okay, if we move in this direction, if we implement these structural reforms, so we all discuss, negotiate, and identify what are the key issues. For example, in this IMF program, they clearly identify there are two key issues. One is, on the one hand, the fiscal consolidation process that has to happen if the country has to go forward in terms of macroeconomic stability. Other one is the build up sufficient reserves to meet future debt obligations. And third one is structural reforms to enhance capacity of the country to grow, like doing business index, custom reforms, inland revenue, VAT reform, all these are the structural reforms. So we all, when we negotiate, we come to an agreement, and collectively on technical basis, we recognize these are the issues, we recognize these are the measures that we have to take on, and we collectively agree. So then we have commitment to implement that if we are going to get financial assistance from the IMF. And that is the reason. If you go to a bank and take a housing loan, wouldn't they ask for you to issue only build the house that you give the loan? If you don't build the house, you won't get that money. So that is a similar, just to make sure money that we are getting are properly utilized and we are moving in the right direction in terms of, as both of us agree. It is not, I don't agree that anyone can dictate terms if we think that is not reasonable. We have the sufficient competency to argue with anyone in the IMF World Bank, say that no, this is not the right thing, this is the way we would address it. So obviously there are also people who have sufficient technical competencies and they all agree.
Dr. Veerasinghe, now if you look at the full automatic full yes. pricing formula, which is delayed, right, that is one of the IMF conditions. Now it has come in a time that it's really difficult for a government to move forward with it. So in the event that we don't see a pricing formula, does that give you the space to negotiate with the IMF on some other reforms or some other aspects that you could?
This pricing formula is necessary. That's also, I don't think government should have done it a lot earlier, in my view. So there's a delay. This pricing formula, if you look at the even without pricing formula, before last time the fuel prices adjusted locally, Sri Lanka was January 2015. Before that, even without a pricing formula, there were regular adjustment in domestic fuel prices just to reflect global prices. From 2015 January so far, this is the longest period in the recent history that fuel prices were not adjusted. Global price came down to $40 a barrel, now $74 a barrel. Don't blame the depreciation. This is 45% to 74%. This is almost 100% value in global. So when you have that kind of situation, if any government which has delayed this thing, is obviously going to face a difficult problem in terms of managing macroeconomy, managing CPC, all these things. If global prices are higher, obviously that consumer will have to pay that. And I just got some numbers. Right now, retail prices of petrol diesel in the region is the lowest in Sri Lanka. Even India, it is higher. In terms of US dollar cents, India, Bangladesh, everywhere, petrol prices are higher. It has been too much delayed, actually, in my view. It should have been done a lot earlier.
Dinesh, I just want to grab your attention to this. Now, Dr. Veerasinghe said it's important to bring a fuel price formula. However, the government did something wrong as soon as they were elected. One was to reduce the fuel prices drastically, and the other was to slap in a 10,000 rupees salary increment to the state sector employees. And this has been viewed as the biggest mistakes that the government ever did. In your opinion, do you think that this was not proper thinking on the part of the government as far as the future is concerned, and that is why we are paying the brunt right now?
Would have been adjusted, but it would have been revised later, much more frequent intervals. Not that fixing all the time after two and a half years up to now.
Yeah.
That's my point.
Dinesh, yeah. In your opinion, how do you view this?
Fuel adjustment and the government sector salaries. The fact that governments keep on doing these things, and this has a huge political view and an understanding on this, but the question is, at whose cost are these the policy, these decisions are working on? The fact is, every relief or any increase has to be connected with a productivity measurement. Without productivity improvements, if we take decisions, it is going to hugely impact the trade.
But you say that every increase, especially when it comes to salaries, should match productivity. What if, for example, do you see the current wages that are being paid, or before the 10,000 rupee increment was granted, was that wage comparable, or was it was there parity between the wage that they were being paid and their living conditions and the work that they were doing? Because, for example, you take a country like Sri Lanka, it's supposed to be a lower middle income country. You have junior level public officials like development officers, some of the field officers, etc. And they're not really making tons of money. their wages are relatively low. It's, you can barely consider it a living wage. So in that kind of a situation, don't you have to also take into consideration the plight of these people? I'm sure that there are people at the top who are maybe getting unnecessary increments and benefits, but is that really the, when we say that government wages are increasing, is that, should we really be taking away what I'm arguing on the side of the unions here, but should we really be saying that no, you don't deserve this 10,000 rupee increment?
No, that's not the point. Everyone wants higher salaries, you know. The question is, you got to look at the model that the private sector is moving on, working, and how the public sector works. You know, we got to have key performance indicators tied up with their operations and their outcomes of the duties. If the increases are not linked to performance, like we do in private sector, increase is going to be a burden. The fact is that we have to face the reality. Yes, people need higher incomes, but at the same time, where are the discharging of responsibilities towards that increase?
But the reason, there's also a reason that I ask this. If you look at it from a macro perspective, in terms of opportunities, especially in terms of youth and youth employment figures, even if you take some of the biggest conglomerates in the country, there are some where junior executives are notoriously lowly paid. I even know of examples where three-wheeler drivers make more money than some junior executives at some pretty big conglomerates. This has sort of driven this culture of a lot of young men, especially, wanting to, go into the three-wheeler business because, you know, if I become a clerk or if I become take on a junior executive position, I'm not really going to be able to set my life up.
Nadim, with your permission, can I pose that question to Professor Seri Hettige, because we're running out of time as well? Yes, Professor.
Well, absolutely. I think the whole issue of productivity is important, but the whole issue of productivity is again connected to the structure of the economy. And that is the point that Dr. Vijayavadhan was trying to make, that the real economy has to grow. The real economy has to be balanced in relation to the money economy. So, you know, monetary expansion alone is not going to help, you know, unless you also really concentrate on commodity production. I mean, the, you know, agricultural sector has an enormous potential which we have not been able to exploit. Similarly, the industrial sector in this country has not, you know, expanded or diversified. So the point is that, you know, unless you strengthen the local economy in terms of commodity production and the production of services and the improvement of the quality of those services, I don't think that you're going to really
make much. Professor Hettige, this is an area, see for example, now the government has been putting money into agricultural research and development, maybe not enough, but we have facilities in Gannoorua, there's agricultural research development, there's a rubber research department, a tea R&D department, so this is there. And for a long time, people have been saying, you know, there's a lot of untapped potential in the agriculture sector. But how long is it going to take us to tap it? Where is the problem here? Is it a problem of economic policy making, or is it just a collapse in governance?
Well, I mean, it's partly related to, you know, policy making process. I mean, you know, unless, you know, you have, you know, policy analysis in each one of these sectors, and, you know, use that policy analysis to come up with policy options which can then be considered by, you know, government, I don't think that you're going to make, I mean, research institutes, I remember, you know, the Agrarian Research and Training Institute, which was established, if I'm not mistaken, in 1970, I mean, was like a beehive, you know, in the first 10 years. And I could see, you know, very competent, you know, researchers, you know, working on a whole range of issues connected with, you know, rural agriculture. And then, of course, the point is the agricultural diversification. Now, point is, you know, you don't you know, the point is you don't continue to produce, you know, low value added products when you have a, you know, huge cost of production problem with labor, you know, wages going up and so on and so forth. So you have to basically identify commodities that would really give you the, you know, the value for your money. You know, for instance, you know, I mean, there are a number of crops which we would have, you know, developed in this country, which we haven't really not done. So what I'm getting at is that it is really important to concentrate on productivity. But at the same time, you know, the public sector expansion has really not, you know, in keeping with the demand for public services, for instance. I mean, like, for instance, you know, a lot of the graduates that we have recruited over the last, let's say, you know, 5 to 10 years.
Professor Hettige, I'll just stop you there because we're running short of time.
Yes,
and a quick
sir.
Question for Mr. Jasinghe as well. Mr. Jasinghe, and also Mr. Dinesh, as the exporters and importers on this panel, I mean, don't misunderstand, I'm not a raving socialist. I'm very much a proponent of free and fair trade. But the question that I have to ask you as well is that where has this sort of policy making, or where has it gone wrong? Is it a simple lack of policy, whether it's monetary or fiscal policy? Is it a lack of understanding of what the needs of the public, the people and business and industry is? Or is it simply neglect, not wanting to sort of comprehend those needs?
Is your question directed at on skills, or what is it? I mean, it's a very open-ended question, right? I mean,
let's direct it at skills.
Fantastic, right? Now, a lot of our members are complaining that they don't have skilled workers to run their factories. Now, I think at the last time I was at this forum, I think your sister station, is coming together with us to develop skills and go to the village level, at least to bring. Now, one of my members said they go to the village, they bring 10 people to operate their machines. They're off the next day because they say they can do something better. Now, what is that? Either you stay at home or join the state sector where you're assured of a pension. And I think this is a very relevant question. Back in, I think it was 2004, I think, when the government opened up positions for young graduates. Now, the private sector lost wage earners who earn an average of 10,000 rupees, and they left for state jobs for 2,000 rupees. Now, I couldn't understand the logic of that. Now, what this, the ready-made answer given was, one thing, there not much work. And second thing, you get a pension. So in between, we can manage. Now, I think it's a attitude, and a very populist attitude that has permeated down. Now, today, our issue is, as you pointed out earlier, people, a three-wheel driver earns more than a junior executive. It's a fact, because a three-wheel driver can earn a minimum of 5,000 a day, whereas I think even a mid-level manager will not earn that. But then, and yesterday I was coming from out station, I think, I was coming out, and you can see, even if you go out on the streets today, the number of three-wheelers. Now, what is that going to do to serve our economy in the long term? Now, we have a severe dearth of staff, of people to run our industries, be it agriculture, be it manufacturing, which are two vital sectors for the economy and for the export effort. And when you say policy, we have brought these issues up, particularly the three-wheel issue. We have nothing against three-wheel ownership. But then it's a social issue that could come up, and I think the good professor can foresee, and probably he'll tell us where it will lead the country into the country's economy. So these are the microeconomic issues and social issues that we got to address. So right now, as we speak, the National Chamber of Export is embarking on a program, I think through your government, to say that the dignity of labor.
Charles, I'll give you one question.
Yes. Dr. Vijayavadhana, I think the fuel bill, fuel costs amount to somewhere around 25% of our import bill. Is it correct?
40% now.
Okay, so that.
possible.
Right. So if he can't see the pricing formula, if he doesn't see the light of day, what are the other measures that the government could take to curtail fuel consumption?
Well, the best choice is the pricing formula, Charita, because the other alternative is to you have to ration it by a quota system, which means that all of us will have to stand behind in front of a fuel station to buy our fuel, and also those who can buy can sell it in the underground market at a profit. So we are creating a huge underground economy by moving to that, because the best solution which the government should go for now is to go for this fuel formula. And if the government doesn't do it because of the elections that is going, it has to face in the next 2 year period, the result would be the said petroleum corporation would be incurring losses.
And do you think the government could buy more time from the IMF because the next tranche would depend on?
No, I mean the IMF tranche is simply about say $300 to $400 million, which is nothing when we compare with the requirements of the country. Even at this stage, the government can do without the IMF tranche. What would happen to government is if they lost the next tranche, the government would lose the credibility and it will have to pay some additional rate when they borrow money from the international market. And probably government might decide to go for that rather than angering the public of the country by going for the fuel formula. So those are actually political decisions that are made not in the interest of the long-term economic growth, but in the interest of surviving in power, so which is not good for Sri Lanka today.
Sharada, you asked two questions, so that's it? Or you have one more?
I wanted to ask Mr. Jasing about the export strategy, how it's coming into place. Yes.
The export strategy, where we understand, is now in the cabinet and awaiting parliamentary, the passage in parliament.
But you just don't know which minister to go to because there will be a cabinet reshuffle tomorrow.
Right now, it's in the right now it resides in the MODSIT, the Ministry of Development Strategy and Technology.
So tomorrow you would know what's going to happen. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Just to touch upon a few points that was discussed, the three-wheel issue. Three-wheel issue, cutting a long story short, the guys who are in the business already, if they are earning big amounts like 5,000 rupees a day, what will they do next? I mean, how can we solve that issue is a big issue. So, the skilled labor, I think from school time, there has to be a new model working, and there should be crash courses where guys can straight away enter and sharpen their skills and get into some industries which are respected or which are accepted by the society at a different level. So those two are it's easy to say, but it's very difficult to do. And the guys who don't have space for parking, and we know within Colombo the people who are having three-wheelers doesn't have space even for parking. So I think changing this system is going to be a very, very difficult one. About the policies, I think government has a problem in really not understanding the business needs. The importers and the exporters do business, and that is how the government will survive. Import duties, it will be import duties and other rest of the taxes that the trade is paying is the government income. So when more and more, if you tighten the screws and get them to pay more, how if they don't do business then? Where will it end up? It is simply at this stage, we know how the trade works, how people comment about these things. So it is very, very critical that governments, policymakers understand where is the limit that you are going to tax the trade. So payments, if they don't get those expected payments, where will the government rely on?
Thank you very much, Dinesh.
So it's extremely crucial that governments and policymakers listen to the trade, because trade are the people who are doing business. So if you listen to the trade and address their requirements in terms of trade facilitation and ease of doing business ranking to go up, I think we can see some light in the tunnel. It is very, very critical that we do trade facilitation at the highest levels.
Before I go into a short commercial break to sum up with our final round, I have a very quick question to Dr. Ravi Vijayawardena, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. It's about the taxes that have been reduced by the government on individuals and professionals. Dr. Vijayawardena, I happened to go to a private hospital recently. I thought I'd bring this as an example. I happened to go to a private hospital recently, 2 weeks ago, and I was directed to this particular ward in this private hospital to get a special appointment. And there was no one to collect the bills. There was just one individual. Now, tells me the payment is 10,000 rupees. So I ask him, okay, no problem, I can pay the 10,000 rupees. I need a receipt back. And the individual concerned says, no receipts. We just have to collect the money from you, and then you can get the doctor's appointment. So the idea of this particular taxation was to net individuals who make unsolicited money and not paying to the government. And they still continue to do that. And professionals who have already been paying money for the government legally for years and years are continuing to pay money and pay extra. Do you think that this taxation policy that has been brought forward by the government is successful?
Well, I think it's a matter for the Interior Department to expand the tax net. Probably they will do it because they have this new RAMIS system to be implemented. With that, they may be having a better data set in order to capture all the people who are earning money in Sri Lanka. So this is something which had to be done long time ago, but now the capacity of the department is being expanded in order to enable it to get the new tax payers to the tax net.
But isn't it sad, Dr. Vijayawardena, at the end of the day, that you know these are being done by doctors who are liable to pay the government, and the Inland Revenue Department won't even touch these doctors because they're scared that they will go on strike.
That's true. I mean, they are actually Samir going behind the people who are genuinely paying taxes rather than trying to get the people who have been avoiding the payment of taxes. It's happening.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Vijayawardena, for your thoughts as well. We're going for a short commercial break. When we come back, it's a final round. Stay connected. Stay with Face the Nation. Welcome back. This is Face the Nation. We start off the final round with Dinesh De Silva, immediate past chairman, Import Section, Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Dinesh, you're the one who's being sidelined from all this. Dr. Veerasinghe says that the exporters cannot complain, but did not make any reference to the importers. At the end of the day, you are the one who's being sidelined. In a situation like that, what is the message you have for the government of Sri Lanka?
Yeah, I think your question itself has the answer. So we should not be sidelined in the first place, right? And the fact is that importers have been taken for granted, I guess, because there's so much of revenue being generated by doing imports to this country. And now it is alarming. It's certainly alarming because we have seen people talking of not doing business. And I think we have to be optimistic about the whole thing. We are in the process of automating. There are some initiatives coming under the WTO agreement where there will be very soon at the National Trade Facilitation level. We are doing a trade information portal and a national single window. Those are on track. Those are two major projects that are currently happening. And we are expecting during this year, middle of this year, for the information portal to be up and running. And towards the end of this year or early next year to see a national single window. Blueprint is being done and a lot of progress in that area. So we strongly believe in the trade, this kind of automation and the speed of transaction improves means there will be a game changer in the entire trade. We are strongly believing in these two major projects. And also we are pushing for the legal changes. I would say without doing the laws, changing the laws, the trade is going to suffer more and more. But I guess we are on the right track. We are fully focusing on these things and we will do everything possible to support the government to make these changes, because importers, exporters will be doing business. It's actually not the government who is doing business. So they have a duty to look after the trade.
Thank you very much, Dinesh De Silva, Immediate Past Chairman, Import Section of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. I now move to the exporter in the house, that is Ramal Jasingha, President, National Chamber of Exporters. Ramal, based on what Dr. Veerasinghe said, you cannot complain. There is no way that you can make any complaints. You're earning money and you have to continue keep earning money. But my question to you is very simple. What is the message or what is the plea that you have for the central bank as well as the government of the country? You have one man who is also responsible, that is a senior deputy governor, Central Bank of Sri Lanka, next to you. If you were to have a closed-door meeting with Dr. Veerasinghe, what would be the key points that you would raise?
One thing is, there is a silver lining in the cloud. We have seen in 2017, month over month, and even early this year, an improvement, consistent improvement in exports. But it's just reached 10.8 billion. And it's half of what we import. Yes, we will certainly exploit the devaluation of the rupee. We will definitely exploit this situation. But again, we got to keep our eyes on the cost of production and cost of delivery, and also to have consistent policy in terms of taxation, in terms of interest rates. We got to have some form of consistency. So if I were to have a closed door meeting with Dr. Veerasinghe, it would be stare into the crystal ball and then see, okay, this is where we are, and come back with a good margin of confidence and comfort. And again, as I said at the start, playing the devil's advocate, I think the central bank is now going through consistent policy making, finding its role more and more professional, if I can call it. And our issue is that it's all coming in at once, and we got to cope with it. So we got to have the other links in our value chain tightened, particularly on research and development, import substitution, and then we might see the light at the end of the day. So we will certainly be making hay while the sun shines.
Thank you very much, Ramal Jasingha, President, National Chamber of Exporters. I now move to Professor Siri Hettige, Emeritus Professor, Department of Sociology, University of Colombo. Professor Hettige, let's say you represent the people of Sri Lanka. At this present moment of time, what would be the plea that you have for the government of Sri Lanka in terms of ensuring that people at least have a light end of the tunnel? Because we saw in 2009, during the final stage of the conflict, the government went out and said, guess what, tighten your belts, we need the support of the people. We don't have a conflict anymore. We have just public mismanagement of debt as well as mismanagement of policy. What is the message you have for the government?
Well, I think the point is that the government has to send certain positive signals to the wider public that we really mean business, we are serious about addressing issues that have accumulated over the years, and that we are really going to rationalize the way the government machinery functions. I don't think that we have really given that message at all to the people, which creates a sense of hopelessness, in the sense that people really look for the exact opposite of what you described. That is, they would like to see rational management of public affairs. It's not short-termism that we are worried about here. That is really not going to get us anywhere. We certainly have to think in terms of long-term policies. I mean, the issues that we are confronted with are very clear. I mean, the education and, you know, skills nexus has to be addressed, and, you know, and the policy making body in the education sector, National Education Commission, has come out with these things over the last 20 years, but nothing has been done. I think that's the whole problem. So we have to really recognize the very clear linkage between education and skill development, which is really lacking in the world. And the other thing is, of course, you know, this whole issue of young people, you know, basically starting to drive three wheels. The point is that, you know, this is one of the critical functions of the state. It's not only policy making. The state has to regulate public affairs. Now, this is really a public affair that we are talking about. You know, what is the number of three wheels that we have? 1.2 million three wheels. Say, for instance, what is the number of three wheels that you require for Colombo? I mean, the point is that we really can manage these things in a more rational way. I'm not saying that you should drive these people to the ground, you know, to the wall. But the point is that there is a need to really, you know, rationalize all these activities, you know, whether it is three-wheel driving, whether it is private tuition, whether it is anything else. So the point is, you know, we have to reduce, you know, economic pressure on low-income groups. You know, for instance, as I already mentioned, you know, the lower income groups, like especially the 50%, lower 50%, are coming under more and more pressure. Now, devaluation of the rupee will put more and more pressure on them. So how can you really take the pressure off? I think there are certain areas where you have to really pay attention to, you know, what are the things that people are spending money on? Those are areas which are very important. And I think those areas can be really addressed through sound public policy.
Thank you very much, Professor Siri Hettig, Emeritus Professor, Department of Sociology, University of Colombo. I now move my attention to Dr. W. Vijayawardena, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Dr. Vijayawardena, where are we really heading? You're coming to the show after many, many months. My question to you is very simple, as I always ask you. Are you as positive as Ramal, saying that there's a silver lining that we can see at the moment, or are you still negative about how this country is moving forward as far as the country's economy is concerned? Your time starts now.
Yeah, of course, Samir, all of us should have expectations and hopes, because without hopes we will not be able to move forward. And what is presently worrying us is that the government doesn't display any commitment to introducing a sound policy package which could be decided on the basis of the future of Sri Lanka rather than instead of going for this cheap political popularity. Presently, you'd have noted that the government is going to recruit another 60,000 unemployed graduates to the government sector. When there are not even places for these people to sit, and there are no job descriptions, and it's at the end of the day, it's the taxpayers who will have to bear the bill. And if the taxes are not sufficient, the government will have to borrow money. If the borrowings are not sufficient, the government has to get the central bank to print money. So anyway, the future economic growth is going to be compromised. So because of this reason, I think what we have to stress to the government is that even though it is to face several elections in the next 2 year period, if it postpones the needed structural economic reforms, the Sri Lanka economy would be moving towards this negative end, as you have mentioned here.
Thank you very much, Dr. W. Vijayawardena, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. I now move my attention to Dr. Nandalal Veerasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor, Central Bank of Sri Lanka. Dr. Veerasinghe, if a hypothetical, let's say, you have the magic wand in your hand and you want to make some changes, what would be the changes you would instill in the system for us to move forward and have a strong economy? Your time starts now.
Yeah, I think because both imports and exporters here, I just want to mention one thing that is, imports are also important. So I'm not saying imports should be restricted. If you are importing $20 billion worth of goods, we should be exporting $30 billion. That's the point. So we need to promote export. That's one thing. Second one, in terms of what to do, how to do, certainly the central bank, you have a large number of stakeholders. Central bank, in terms of what we do, is to maintain economic and price stability and financial system stability. Those are two three things. But there are government, the politicians, and the NGOs, and the private sector, imports and exporters, all will have to play their role to bring address all the skill enhancement, doing business improvements, customs, all the reforms, and also other point on the imports, the trade, simplification of trade and bringing down paratariffs is very important. You see, now these days, export is not one product, it's a supply chain. For you to improve supply chain, you should be able to import on a more transparent, lower cost, and then advalorem exports. That's the way a lot of countries are doing business. So that's where the reforms that he was talking about are very important. Not only those reforms, there are a lot of other things that we discuss here. It's the collective effort of all stakeholders to move in the right direction and institutionalize. That's an important point, what I would stress all the time. Instead of business cycle synchronized with the election cycle, you institutionalize all the reforms and have a consistent, predictable policy so that everyone can do business in a much more transparent manner. That's the way to go, I think.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nandalal Virasinghe, for joining us this evening. Thank you very much, Professor Siri Hettigi, for joining us this evening on the show. Ramal Jasinghe, President, National Chamber of Exporters. A special thank you to Dr. Nandalal Virasinghe, Senior Deputy Governor, Central Bank of Sri Lanka, for joining us this evening. At a time when politicians and ministers are shying away, it's always nice to have public sector officials setting the tone and being transparent and coming to the limelight and ensuring that the questions are answered. Thank you very much, Dr. W. Vijayavardhana, former Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. It's always a pleasure to have you on board. And thank you very much, Dinesh De Silva, representing the importers. He's the immediate past chairman of the import section of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce. Let's hope and pray they take the importers seriously. So thank you very much for joining us this evening on the show. Thank you very much, Nadeem, and thank you very much, Sharita, for joining us this evening on the show tonight. Very quickly, I leave you tonight with a quote, as I always do. Inflation is like toothpaste. Once it's out, you can hardly get it back in again. Check ya, and good night.